I'm Beverly Weaver, and welcome to Denver Decides. This community partnership is dedicated to accessible and transparent elections. The partnership includes the League of Women Voters of Denver, Interneighborhood Cooperation, and is presented by Denver 8 TV. Our mission today is to present a candidate forum in anticipation of the general election coming up on Tuesday, November 8th. Among other offices, this election includes the candidates vying to be the state's second judicial district attorney. The district attorney is the chief law enforcement officer in the city and county of Denver and is responsible for prosecuting all of the felonies, misdemeanors, and serious traffic offenses committed in the city. Our format is a pretty standard one. The candidates will have timed opening and closing statements. We'll begin with opening statements, and that'll be followed by rounds of questions that have been submitted by the organizers of the forum, as well as the public speaking and civic engagement students from Metropolitan State University. Now, since we do have a time limit, we may not be able to get to all of the submitted questions, but both candidates will answer all the questions, and all of their answers will be timed. Our timers, ladies, as you can see, are out here in front, where hopefully you can see the cards that they hold up. So let's begin by meeting the candidates for Denver's next district attorney. The candidates facing left to right, facing the audience in the order that their names will appear on the November ballot. So beginning at my right is Beth McCann, and on my left is Helen Morgan. Let's please welcome them, audience, if you would, to the forum. All right. Thank you so much, ladies, for being here. We're going to begin. And one quick note I want to throw in as well. On behalf of the forum organizers, the audience here tonight, and of course our viewers at home, we sincerely urge both of you to be honest, direct, and forthright to help voters really distinguish one candidate for another in this race. All right, we are going to begin with a 1.5 minute opening statement from each of the candidates. And with this, we'll proceed in ballot order with these statements. So once again, starting at my right, Beth McCann, you'll go first and you have 90 seconds.
Thank you very much, Beverly. It's time for a new direction in the Denver District Attorney's Office. We need to be providing more alternatives for young people who end up in the system so one mistake doesn't ruin a child's life. We also need to provide treatment options for people with mental health and substance abuse issues so that we aren't warehousing them in our jails. We really need to be looking at, are we incarcerating the right people for the right reasons? The Denver DA's office also needs to be in the community more. It needs to be transparent and it needs to be accountable. The office needs a leader from the outside. And I am uniquely qualified to lead the office forward. I have prosecuted the law as a deputy and chief deputy district attorney. I have managed the law as the manager of safety and in the attorney general's office. And I have made the law as a legislator here in Denver. When I was Denver's manager of safety, we worked with the community to develop the Safe City Plan to keep kids out of gangs and drugs and violence. And we need to continue that work. In the legislature, I've been able to pass several laws to improve, strengthen our criminal justice system, and make our lives better here in Denver and Colorado. I'm Beth McCann. As Denver's next district attorney, I have the experience, the commitment, and the background to move Denver forward, to bring justice for all, and to serve as a Denver, make Denver a national leader in criminal justice reform. Thank you.
Thank you. And let's turn to Helen Morgan for your opening statement. You also have a minute and a half.
Thank you, Beverly. Thank you, INC. Thank you, Channel 8. And thank you, League of Women Voters, for hosting this forum tonight. My name is Helen Morgan. And on February 24th of 1994, I took an oath to do justice, to support the constitutions of the United States and of this great state of Colorado. And I have spent the last 22 years trying to achieve that goal. I am running as an independent candidate for Denver District Attorney because I don't believe that politics should have anything to do with who your chief law enforcement officer is. This evening, I look forward to explaining to you about my vast experience, ranging from being a community prosecutor in Capitol Hill, to prosecuting a white supremacist prison gang, to reformulating our drug court back in 2007. My vision for the Denver District Attorney's Office is based on three tenets: accountability, transparency, and public safety. I look forward this evening to continuing that conversation. Thank you for tuning in.
All right. Thanks, ladies, for those opening statements. We're going to start into our question and answer period now, and each candidate will have a minute to respond to each question. With this, we'll start in reverse order, so you'll go first, Ms. Morgan. First question from our organizers. How do you plan on lowering the incarceration rates in Denver?
The key to lowering incarceration is to do an assessment of risk for each and every individual as we look at whether or not they enter the criminal justice system. Right now, unfortunately, so much of our jail population is based on our people who have mental health issues, who have drug abuse issues, and we do not provide the appropriate treatment for them, and so they end up incarcerated. So by doing an assessment of risk at the beginning of every case, we can better assess those who can be safely supervised in the community and those who need to be incarcerated. We also need to establish an adult diversion program that mirrors our juvenile diversion program. That will keep people out of the system who don't need to be there in the first place. One of the most important things that the DA does is be the gatekeeper, and I look forward to robustly enforcing that particular role.
Okay, Ms. McCann, let's come to you for that same question.
Yes, you know, we're incarcerating more people in the United States than any other country in the world, which is pretty shocking when you think about it. So I plan to actually do an evaluation of how we're making the decisions about filing cases, particularly our lower level cases. We need to do a review of what those decisions are, and I will train our deputies to make decisions, exercise good judgment based on really what kinds of cases do we really need to be prosecuting? I would like to start pre-booking diversion so that the person does not have to be charged in order to get into an alternative program or a diversion program, and to be able to provide pathways for young people so that they can get out of the criminal justice system before they really get into that revolving door. We've got to decide who we should be incarcerating for the right reasons.
All right. You mentioned the revolving door, and Beth, we're going to come back to you for this next question. What is your plan to reduce recidivism rates in Colorado, and how will this plan be paid for? 1 minute.
So we aren't doing a good enough job of preparing people for life after prison. In the legislature, I've been very supportive of the additional funding to provide training for those who are incarcerated and who will be getting out. So we need the training in the department, but we also need those wraparound services when people get out. And there's some good efforts going on in Denver. The Second Chance Center is doing a very good job of helping people find jobs and find housing. We need to put more resources into those kinds of programs so that when people come out, they can actually get a job. I did sponsor a bill in the legislature to take the box off of employment applications about criminal history so that employers could ask it later, but not on the initial application, to help people at least be able to get an interview and explain their background. The bill passed the House, didn't make it out of the Senate, but I expect that bill will come back, and I will be supporting those kinds of efforts to give people that second chance when they get out of prison.
Okay, and let's come to you, Ms. Morgan, for your response.
Thank you. You know, Beth's first response was talking about people coming out of the Department of Corrections, but the reality is for Denver, 12,000 of our cases a year are misdemeanor cases, so those people will never go to the Department of Corrections, and the vast majority of people who plead guilty to felonies will likewise never go to the Department of Corrections. So where our focus has to be is with people who are given probationary or community services or community sentences within Denver. As chair of the Traumatic Brain Injury Board, I instituted a program that screened our most needy people within the Denver County Jail, different from the Department of Corrections, identifying those who had traumatic brain injury, and then providing services for those as they got out of jail to assist them in life going forward. The correct and accurate identification of risk and need is what the nation is talking about to reduce recidivism. It's what we did when I reformulated drug court in 2007, when I was part of creating sobriety court, and then also restart court.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We're going to come back to you, Ms. Morgan, for the next question. This one will deal with a more statewide issue. Closing the prison in Las Animas saved the state nearly $27,000 per inmate per year, according to the Denver Post. However, it's been reported that citizens are still being held in prison for weeks and months waiting for a simple court date. What role do you play in changing and expediting this process? And if you have a role, what is your plan to do so?
Well, our role is very limited with the Department of Corrections. We have no jurisdiction over the Department of Corrections. I believe what you're referring to is the issue of the writ system. So it's if somebody, for example, is asking for reconsideration, how long does it take them to get back into court? We are very responsive in Denver to those particular writs. We have an excellent system. And so generally, because we have the DRDC, which is our clearinghouse within Denver, we have very limited wait times for people coming back to Denver. But again, our biggest challenge, I believe, in Denver is not the people going to the Department of Corrections. Although we have to look at people who are being sent and are they being sent for the right reason, it's people who were jailed for mental health issues, for addiction issues, that shouldn't be in jail. We need a public health approach for that.
Okay. Ms. McCann, your response.
So the way I understood the question, it has to do with people waiting for trial. I may have misunderstood, but that's, I think, one of our biggest issues right now is our bail system and our bonding system that unfairly keeps folks in jail who don't have the resources to make bond. And often it's for very, very minor offenses. The man that was died in the Denver County Jail was in on a $100 bond for a trespass. He couldn't make the $100 bond. So I am committed to looking at that bail bonding system and making sure that we don't incarcerate people because they're poor, but rather we actually look at, are they a danger to the community and will they reappear in court? We are holding hundreds of people in our jails waiting for trial, and that's not really what the jail system is designed to do, and it's not fair to those who are unable to make their bonds.
All right. Thanks, ladies, for both of those responses. And now, candidates, you've had a chance to answer three questions and listen to your opponent's answers as well. You're each going to be given 30 seconds to kind of expand perhaps on an answer or perhaps give reference to your opponent's comments. So you may expand. No questions for each other at this point. We'll do that later in the session. But we're going to start with you, Beth. You'll have 30 seconds to expand.
Yes, I think that these questions have raised some of the fundamental issues that we need to address as a criminal justice system as a whole. It isn't all about winning a case or prosecuting a case. It's about justice, and it's about looking at the system through a broader lens. And that's what I bring to this race. I have had experience not only prosecuting, but also leading a large city agency and legislating and making laws that prosecutors enforce.
Okay. Sorry to cut you off, but 30 seconds for you, Helen.
Thank you, Beverly. The theme here is recidivism and unnecessary incarceration of people. In order to effectuate change, you have to have made change. It is not easy to get the Denver Police Department, for example, to agree to changes as we did with the drug court in 2007. And in fact, I'm the person who has had the experience of making the change. When the new DUI bill was passed, which unfortunately I see some flaws in because it does not mandate some incarceration time, whereas lower DUIs do, and that was a bill that was sponsored by Ms. McCann, I worked with people to reformulate that that court.
All right, let's move on to our next question from our forum organizers. And Ms. Morgan, you'll be first on this one. This one has to deal with body cameras for police. Nationwide, a point of contention around body cameras is the time authorities are given to review footage prior to its release. How much time do you think a law enforcement agency should be allotted before body camera footage is released to the public? And how soon after an incident do you believe a family should be able to review it? You have 1 minute.
Thank you. This very much has to be answered on a case-by-case basis. I don't believe we can set into policy or procedure certain timelines. For example, in a complicated case where you may have 15, 20, or 30 body cam videos, you don't want to influence people who may be witnesses ultimately by saying, we're going to release this within 24 hours, and then you may have people who come up and say, I would like to give a statement, and that statement may be based on evidence that they didn't see, but rather they saw on television. So I think you have to be committed to a swift, just, and fair release, again, dependent on the circumstances. As far as the family, I think you must immediately contact the family. Now, the DA's office does the investigation as to whether or not somebody should be charged. It's really the mayor with the auspices of the manager of safety who would contact the family as it relates to ongoing issues. But I think they deserve to be contacted immediately and be part of a conversation as to whether or not or when they can see such video.
All right, and let's move to you, Ms. McCann, for your response. 1 minute as well.
Yes, so I am committed to releasing videos of this nature as soon as we can. I do think the public deserves an opportunity to view them, as well as the family. There are situations where you can't release them immediately because you don't want to influence a witness that maybe has not been talked to yet or interviewed yet. And you don't want them to see a video and then have their recollection influenced by that. However, I believe that we should move as quickly as we can to make sure those videos are available. And I do believe that the family has should have the right to view the videos right away in this circumstance, particularly when there's been a death. I think that working with the family is also part of the responsibility of the district attorney, and reaching out to them is appropriate right away.
All right, thank you. Next question from our sponsoring partners, and also remember the Metropolitan State University students for the candidates for district attorney. We're going to begin again with you, Beth McCann. A two-part question. In your view, what are some examples of community and school-based early interventions that will help with the juvenile system, and what are some alternatives to jail for juveniles?
So I have talked about restorative justice throughout my campaign. In the legislature, we passed a bill to allow state funding for restorative justice programs in DA's offices. There were initially four. Denver did not apply and was not one of them. There are now six DA's offices that are using restorative justice in juvenile cases. Denver is not one of them. I just recently met with the state director, and we are already planning how to start that program here in Denver. And that's a program that has been used successfully in Denver public schools when there are offenses committed in the schools. And they've actually seen a reduction in suspension and expulsion rates. So that's an area that I'm committed to doing immediately. And also, I worked as Safe City Director. We started the Safe City Summit and the plan to work with communities and community-based programs to help keep kids out of gangs and drugs and violence. And we successfully reduced juvenile crime by 20%.
Excellent. Let's come back to Helen, your response to that same question.
Thank you, Beverly. I think the prime example of a program that works in Denver currently is a juvenile diversion program. And so that is, if somebody encounters himself in the criminal justice system, they will be diverted out, so they will not be charged, and they will be given a number of different ways to assist them moving forward, including paying restitution. And there is a restorative justice component to that particular program, and it's robust right now. I think a second piece that is really important is to get back to that gatekeeper piece. You know, we seem to think that if we bring someone into the system, we can help them. Very often, the most helpful thing we can do, most especially for a juvenile, is to keep them out of the system. And so what you have to do is have a robust intake process. Someone who is committed, and I am committed to doing this, someone who is committed to doing the intake on juvenile cases so that those people who never need to step foot into our system never become part of it. It is much better to keep somebody out than keep them in and try and get them out later on.
All right, thank you. Our next question, this is round six of questions for our candidates. Ms. Morgan, you'll begin the response on this. What types of crimes do you believe are fitting for the death penalty, if any? 1 minute.
Well, we have a statutory provision that sets out when, first-degree murder crimes with certain aggravators may be appropriate for the death penalty. So this is what I'll tell you. It's not my personal opinion. It's what the state legislature, as representatives of the state, have said. These may be appropriate. Now, knowing that, the reality is in Denver, we have not had a successful death penalty prosecution in a significant period of time. I think people are very reluctant as jurors to impose the ultimate penalty on somebody. But that does not mean that because it is a lawful option, we must exclude it before such a terrible crime could happen. You can think of examples. You can think of what happened in Aurora if someone didn't have a mental health issue. You can think of other cases in Sandy Hook if somebody, for example, survived, that you would consider it. And I think it is a violation of the Victims' Rights Amendment to say, I will not seek the death penalty before such heinous crime occurs.
Okay, thank you. And let's come to Beth McCann, same question.
Thank you, Beverly. I am opposed to the death penalty. I do not feel that the state should be in the business of executing people. And I have actually voted to repeal the death penalty in the legislature. I will not seek the death penalty. I do believe that under the Victims' Rights Act, I have an obligation and will fulfill that to sit down with a victim's family and talk with them about my belief in with respect to the death penalty, and also let them have an opportunity to discuss their viewpoints with me. I also think it's important to remember that these cases, if the death penalty is sought, take months and months and months of work, and sometimes in the millions of dollars, of taxpayer dollars, and we're not seeing convictions. So the emotional toll and the financial toll and the time that they take, I don't think justifies bringing the death penalty in when we have not gotten those convictions in Denver.
Okay, and let's move back to another follow-up segment for you candidates for district attorney. This, you'll have an opportunity to talk for about a minute, and again, it's going to be expanding on something you've said, perhaps what your opponent has said. You do have a minute. We're going to begin with you, Ms. McCann.
Well, we've discussed a number of issues that face the criminal justice system. Among them is the fact that we do incarcerate so many people, and also that we aren't really breaking the cycle of crime. And that's what I really want to do. And that encompasses prevention, as well as prosecution and rehabilitation. So, as I was mentioning, in the Safe City program, we were able to put resources into Denver based for community-based programs that worked with young people. And we actually made a difference in Denver. And I'm convinced that if we put resources and commitment toward prevention, we can make a difference here in Denver. Then we need excellent, well-trained prosecutors who have good judgment, know how to exercise it. And I'm committed to making sure that my deputies do have and exercise good judgment. And then we also need to be putting resources into preparing people for life after prison.
Okay. And Ms. Morgan, 1 minute for a follow-up.
Thank you. You know, it's all very well and good to talk about school programs, and those are wonderful in a general sense. But the job of the DA is to prosecute those cases that come within her office, whether they be the 12,000 misdemeanor cases or the 7,000 felony cases, and then to keep people out who do not need to be there. We have limited resources within the Denver District Attorney's Office. And I'll give you the example of county court where I'm currently chief. We have 5,000 driving under suspension cases a year. Now, those particular cases don't need to be part of my county court system. Those can be part of a system in which people are helped to get their driver's license. That's a good use of resources, because I also have over 700 domestic violence cases a year, and those we have to focus on. So, yes, should somebody be in the schools? Absolutely. Should we keep school children out of our system? Absolutely. Is it our job to run the school program? I don't believe so.
Okay. Thank you, ladies. And this next round is going to be an opportunity for you to ask a question of each other. So you'll have an opportunity to ask that question. They will have a minute to respond. We're going to begin with you, Helen Morgan. You'll have an opportunity for a Beth for question for Beth.
Thank you. Beth, I have a question for you about Veterans Court, because we have done a number of these forums, and it's always been a pleasure. And you've talked a lot about establishing a Veterans Court. So I have sort of a three-part question to it, and I think a minute is a fair response time. My question is, would you establish it in district or county court? If you establish it in district, how would it be different from our veterans track in drug court? And what data do you have that supports the establishment of such a court?
So thank you for that question, Helen. I have looked at veterans courts that are in existence in Arapahoe and Jeffco and some of the other counties. And the reports that I have gotten indicate that they are having an influence and being successful in some cases, not in all, but in keeping veterans from reoffending or from having to go to prison or jail for an offense. My dad was a career Army man, so I'm an Army brat, and I believe really strongly that our veterans are people that we need to be supporting as a community. So my goal is to establish a veterans court in Denver so that those veterans who are returning with post-traumatic stress disorder or some other mental health issue or substance abuse issue will be treated in a way that addresses the issues that they are facing, rather than being charged and going to prison.
Okay. And Ms. McCann, you have a question for Helen.
Yes. Helen, I was curious about why you switched your voter registration from Democrat, which you've been your whole life, to unaffiliated right before this primary, so you did not have to go through a rather tough and grueling primary. I was just wondering why you did that.
Absolutely. I'd be delighted to answer that, Beth. You know, I don't think it should only be Democrats who vote on their chief law enforcement officer in Denver. I believe that everybody should have the opportunity to make a decision. And I'll also tell you, when I've worked for 22 years in the Denver DA's office, when I've talked to police officers, to probation officers, to defense lawyers, never once has it occurred to me to say, what's your political affiliation? I've never sat down with a victim's family and said, tell me how you vote, because then that's going to impact whether or not you get to decide if I'm DA. You know, I looked at it for a long time, and in my heart, that's what said to me, it's the right way to go so that everybody gets a choice. And you too could have done that, Beth, but as a career politician, you decided not to.
All right. Thanks, ladies. And this is going well, so let's continue the one-on-one questioning. Helen, you have another opportunity for a question for Beth.
Thank you. Beth, you have talked about, in some of our forums, about Department of Corrections and in providing more mental health services within the Department of Corrections. What role do you think the Denver District Attorney has in providing mental health services in a system in which you have no jurisdiction?
So what I typically talk about is providing mental health services before people get into the system, not so much after they're in the department. But having said that, I think the district attorney has a very important role to play in discussing and talking about this issue and keeping it in the forefront. I'm on a committee with the director of the Department of Corrections, and we are looking at mental health in the criminal justice system. And the director, Reimisch, talks about the fact that he doesn't feel that his department has enough resources to handle some of the folks that end up there for mental health reasons. So what I want to do is address that at an earlier stage, so we're not actually looking at mental health issues as much after they get in the system, but hopefully before, and preventing repeat of prison or jail for people with mental health.
Okay. And Beth, you have another opportunity for a question for Helen. 1 minute response time.
Yes. So Helen, you talk about reformulating the drug court, but my understanding is that the drug court has continued along for several years and has been relatively successful. So are you planning to do further reformulation of the drug court should you win?
I think that one of the very first things whoever wins you need to do is look at our problem-solving court system within Denver, because there are issues. Let me tell you, when I reformulated drug court in 2007, that was as a result of the Crime Prevention and Control Commission giving us over $1 million really to reformulate the entire system. It started in the mid-90s. I was a deputy in drug court then. Then it moved from district court down into a magistrate situation. We had no particular intake, and so when you say that drug court continued, I don't think that's an accurate representation of what was happening. We had some magistrates doing some treatment. So it was the Crime Prevention and Control Commission money as part of the bond issue for the new jail that gave us the opportunity to come together as a team, and I eventually led that team to redo 180 degrees from what we were doing to provide the best possible treatment and mental health services for those who need it most. And I'm very proud of that. It's one of my proudest achievements.
All right. And Helen, another question for Beth. She'll have a minute response time.
Beth, you have just mentioned that you will not seek the death penalty, but yet you will sit down with a family and have them express their views. How do you justify, or how do you explain that meets treating somebody with respect and dignity when you've already made up your mind what you're going to do or what you're not going to do?
So, Helen, I believe strongly that the state should not put people to death. And so I have said that publicly. But I do believe that I can have a discussion with a victim's family and listen to them, at the same time explaining to them why I don't think it's worth the time and money and emotional toll that bringing the death penalty charge takes in Denver, when we know that it's unlikely we will get a conviction, because the last case where the death penalty was brought did not result in a conviction, and it was a pretty brutal, awful, it was a very brutal, awful situation. So I believe that I will be able to do that in a way that respects the victim, but also informs them about the difficulty of the death penalty, seeking the death penalty.
Okay. And Beth, you have another opportunity for a question for Helen.
So Helen, you've been in the office for 22 years.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe you've done any other legal work or any other work before or during the time you've been in the DA's office. Am I correct there?
I worked as an organization called Housing for All before I joined the Denver District Attorney's Office, and then I also clerked for a judge for 2 years before that.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Another follow-up, ladies. So this will be another chance for you to have a little expansion, perhaps on one of your ideas or one of your opponent's ideas. This time you'll have a minute to do so, and Ms. Morgan will begin with you for a follow-up.
Thank you. I'd like to follow up with Beth's comments about Veterans Court. I would bring to your attention that she didn't actually answer the question, which is, would it be in district court or county court, and what is the data that supports it? And the reason I want to talk about that is problem-solving courts are so important for the right people, but they drain resources. And right now in Denver, we have a veterans track within our drug court. We have less than 15 people who are currently engaged in that particular system, and they're getting the very support that Beth talks about. So my concern is, by saying I will establish this or I will establish that, that is, it is meant as a political promise to garner votes rather than based on what we really need. What we really need, as I've mentioned before, is a thorough assessment of the problem-solving courts we have now, and then move forward in partnership with the people I have worked with for 22 years to establish the best support for people who really need it.
Okay, thank you. And Ms. McCann, you have a minute as well.
Thank you. Well, Helen's been in the office for 22 years, and if this review of the problem-solving courts was necessary or needed, I'm surprised that she hasn't done that previously or made sure that happened, particularly because she's been involved in the drug court situation.
What I'm talking about with Veterans Court is not just drug issues, but also mental health issues. And I've talked to some veterans about the fact that many of them do feel that they come back from combat with mental health issues. And we know that we see veterans getting involved in some violent situations, and some of that can be triggered, and I hate to use that word, but triggered by memories or hearing loud noises from their experience. So I think we really owe them the opportunity to have a court where their concerns are addressed independently, and where we can look at individually what's an appropriate resolution for a case in which they're involved.
Okay. Thank you, ladies. I believe now we're going to return to some more one-on-one questions of each other. Madam Producer, correct me if I'm wrong on that. I believe she's checking on that. But we do want to give you another opportunity to ask a few more questions of each other. So, Beth, you'll begin with a question for Helen, and she'll have a minute response time.
Helen, let me think a minute, because I wasn't expecting that. I thought we were going back to the regular questions. So one of the things that interests me is, given the amount of time you've been in the DA's office, there's been a lot of criticism of the office in terms of accessibility and accountability. And I wonder what you've done to make sure that Mitch Morrissey has been more accountable and accessible to the community.
Well, that's a great question, Beth. And as you know, Mitch Morrissey is not accountable to me. I am accountable to Mitch Morrissey. And I will tell you that in some ways, I'm very much like Mitch Morrissey, to the extent that I am an experienced prosecutor who has tried hundreds of cases and every type of cases. But in other ways, I'm nothing like Mitch Morrissey. I was a community prosecutor in the late 1990s. I enjoyed my work both in Globeville, because I'm a Spanish speaker, and in Capitol Hill. And I am, by nature, a bridge builder. And so as DA, I look forward to getting back in community and continuing to do that work that I have done. If I had been at the helm in the last 12 years, transparency would have increased. And I very much look forward to having that as part of my tenure. But as I said, Mitch Morrissey's my boss. I'm not his.
Okay, Helen, you have another question for Beth?
Yes, Beth, right now Mitch Morrissey does a review of all potential homicide dispositions. He looks at the facts of the case and he makes a determination about whether or not a disposition short of trial is appropriate in conjunction with the victim's families and the deputies. You have not been a prosecutor since 1983. Do you intend to continue that process? And if so, do you think you have the experience to be well regarded by the deputies who bring those cases to you?
Absolutely. I intend to continue that process. And absolutely, I have the experience and the background to do so. When I was in the DA's office, I rose very quickly through the ranks. I went through county court, juvenile court, and became a chief deputy pretty quickly in district court. And I handled many homicide cases. I was a mentor to many of the young lawyers who are still friends of mine now. And I am familiar with the law. I've been writing the law, Helen. I've been writing criminal law. I've been writing other kinds of law as well. I know how laws are made, and I know how they're enforced. I was also the manager of safety, so I know how the police department works. I know how they enforce the laws when they're out on the street and the kinds of evidence that we need in order to prove a case. And although I wasn't in criminal court recently, I have definitely been trying cases in civil court. And evidentiary issues are the same.
Thank you.
Basically.
All right. Thank you, ladies, and thank you for coming up for those with those last-minute questions. We apologize for that. We had a little bit of extra time, but we're going to close out our Q&A session at this point and move now to closing statements. And with this, you'll have a minute and a half for a closing statement. Ms. Morgan, we'll start with you, because we're going to reverse the ballot order, so you have 90 seconds when you're ready.
Thank you. And thank you again for watching, for coming this evening. It's really been a pleasure. I'm entirely confident we could have spent another 2 or 3 hours discussing these very important issues. And that's what's really before you. The very important issue of who will be your chief law enforcement officer in Denver in January of 2017. And there's a stark difference between my opponent and I. You have standing before you a woman with 22 years of experience who has tried over 20 homicide cases, including those that involve complicated DNA issues, unlike my opponent, who was last in a criminal courtroom in 1983. And with all due respect, the rules that apply to criminal cases are not the same as those that apply to civil cases. You need someone with proven leadership who has had and made change, who has effectuated the difference between a drug court that didn't work into a drug court that does work, but also has the courage to say the drug court could be better. I have not made this evening any political promises that I cannot keep. Within the next few days, I'm thrilled to announce that I am going to be revealing my 90-day plan. You can go to my website, Helen Morgan for DA, and see what I am going to do, what concrete steps I will take to make our office more visible, more accountable, and more in the community. This is an important election, unlike no other. And it is something that I rely on your common sense to look at and say, we want a prosecutor, not a politician, in the DA's office in January. Thank you so much.
All right, let's turn to Beth McCann, your closing statement, 90 seconds.
Thank you. And thank you all for listening and paying attention to this election. It is an important election as to who will be your next district attorney. You know, when I graduated from law school, I had a choice about how I was going to use my legal education, and I chose public service because I believe in making people's lives better and in working to change systems that aren't working as well as they could. And I'm proud of the fact that I have spent my career making changes and working to make our lives better here in Denver and Colorado. When I was elected as a state representative 8 years ago, I took an oath and a promise to serve the city and the state. And my community reelected me because they believe in those values and they believe in the work that I was able to do. I have written the laws that prosecutors use to prosecute. And what I bring is a broader vision, looking at the criminal justice system through a wider lens. This office needs more than a prosecutor. It needs a leader, a proven leader, who understands the impact that decisions that are made have on everyone who lives in our city. And the DA's office needs a leader who has shown the ability to make those kinds of changes. I'm running for Denver DA because we need to break the cycle of violence. And I have taken on tough issues throughout my legislative career, and I intend to take on those tough issues again, and I look forward to serving as your next Denver DA.
All right, now it's the audience's chance here in the studio. Let's give the candidates for DA a big round of applause. Thanks so much to both of you for being here.
Thank you.
Our thanks also go out to the Denver Decides partners, which include the Inter-Neighborhood Cooperation, the League of Women Voters of Denver. Denver Decides, of course, is presented by Denver ATV. A special thanks also to the public speaking and civic engagement students from Metropolitan State University for their participation in helping with our questions. Remember, the election is Tuesday, November 8th. Let your voice be heard. Be sure you are registered and be sure to vote. For complete election information online, go to denverdecides.org. I'm Beverly Weaver. Thanks so much for joining us tonight.